is levels of consciousness in psychotherapy, and how we use those, and how they use us, and how we get into these states of consciousness, and what we do in therapy when we get there. And so I'd like to take you through these concentric circles, starting with the one at the bottom, the most distant one. And at this level, you want the maximum distance from the client, because you are basically in a state of fear. In the pre-personal, the true magic mythic way of thinking, it's full of fear. And so you believe in things like evil spirits and exorcism and all this kind of thing, which is really quite dangerous and quite unpleasant. In our culture, we don't get mixed up with this very, very much. We don't actually have a lot of dealings with that, unless we deal with people from other cultures. I'm not going to say a lot about that, except that the distinguishing feature, really, of the earlier states of consciousness that we get into is that they are full of fear. They don't have access to the transpersonal. They are called magic mythic, but it's a pre-personal magic and a pre-personal mythic, which means that you really believe that there are evil spirits and they might do you harm. It's not an interesting theory or a nice idea or a frightening idea. It's a real truth. And so this is a difficult area. And what happens is that the practitioner gets maximum safety by putting magic circles, by having prayers to of protection, of having protective movements and incantations and so on and so forth. So that is an important state of consciousness to know about, because if you do come across it, you may find yourself in real trouble. And it's better to refer such a person to their priest or their medicine man or their shaman or whatever is their own cultural truth. The next level is much more common, much more usual. And this is our everyday level of consciousness, what we call the instrumental level or the mental ego level. And at this level, what we are interested in is treating the client. Treating the client. That is, making them better, curing them, making them happier, or making them more content, or whatever the aim is. And you carry on your psycho-spiritual development, you as a therapist come into the next circle, which is called the authentic, the centaur, the real self, this kind of thing. And at this level, we believe that we have a real self, and we believe that the client also has a real self, but probably doesn't realize it yet. And so what we have to do with the client is to gradually move them from the mental ego into the centaur, into the authentic state. And that's what a great deal of therapy consists of. And at that stage, we are not interested in cure. We are not interested in treatment. We are interested in genuinely meeting the client. And the whole, with our psycho-spiritual development, we reach the causal, right in the center of your diagram. And at that level, there are no symbols. There are no images. There are no gods and goddesses. There are no angels. There's nothing. There's no concepts. There's no words. There's no nothing to do, nothing to be. It's just pure, what the Buddhists call the shunyata, the void. And so you can't really say anything about the causal. You have to shut up at that point. You have to shut your mouth and just be without any kind of processing. So, in the past, I used to say that you couldn't possibly do therapy at the causal level, because at the causal level there are no problems. And so a client comes to you, they want you to take their problems seriously. They don't want you to tell them there's no problems. It's a bit of an insult to some people to say, you think you've got problems, there are no problems. It's a paradoxical, difficult thing to say to people. But what I've discovered is that it is in fact possible to do therapy at the causal level, if the person is ready for it, if the client is ready to do that. And so some of the clients who come to me now are ready for it, and some of them do. And I have had a whole session, for example, with one person where there was complete silence from beginning to end of the session. And it was a very rich silence. There was a lot happening in that silence. Between us, there was interplay going on without any need for words.
And a good therapist, is it like a development ladder, what you just showed here, or you would say that one or the other may have been more specialized on one area than the other? So it's a personal subject, or it's like a development past, which also somehow describes the quality of the therapist?
No, I think that's an important question. What I say is that the further that you've gone along the path, the more choice you've got as to what level to work at with a client. In other words, the further you've gone yourself, the greater your ability to meet the client at the client's level. It's no use you being at one level and the client being at a different level. You have to be on the same level as the client. Now, it may be that the client moves during the course of a session or a series of sessions. That's all obviously possible. But the job of the therapist is not to be one step ahead of the client, really. The job of the client is to be, job of the therapist is to be with the client, right there, beside the client, on the same level as the client, communicating with the client on the client's terms. That's very important, because as soon as the therapist has the aim of moving the client to somewhere else, I think that's not what therapy is really about. I think as soon as a therapist has an aim, that's not such a great idea. As soon as you have an aim, you might fail at achieving it. And we don't want to fail. We just want to be there. And the great thing that a therapist can do is to be there, is to be present. That's it. That's the main job of the therapist, in my book. Causal level. There's nothing special that you have to say or do. You just have to say whatever you want to say. That would be that you could take to a session with a causal therapist. What will happen is... you will sit here or here, and I will sit here or here, and I will go into a causal state, which I can do because I've been meditating since 1982 every morning, and so I know these states and stages very well. So as soon as I open my eyes, the clown starts talking. And from that point on, we just work in whatever way happens, so who would be like to be the client? You didn't wait. Yeah. Okay. Would you rather sit there or there? Okay. Right, well, now you must have one of these. Where's my man? Could she have one of these? That's right. Okay.
I want to get completely rid of my mind.
And who is this that wants to get rid of their mind?
The part of myself that wants to love.
It's already very complicated. You've got a self, you've got a part of the self, you've got the me, you've got the I. How many more of you is there?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Well, it's very complicated. Sounds to me like too complicated. Why don't you dump all that stuff?
Yes. Well, I'm going to.
Okay. Now?
What do you have to do?
What do you want me to do?
Nothing. But you really, really, really have to do nothing. A little bit of nothing won't help. It's got to be all nothing. Ha, 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 ha who needs all this suffering, all this feeling, all this emotion? Who needs it?
No one.
Is that the end, or would you like to say some more?
No.
Okay.
It's okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have no aim.
Yeah.
Did you really not have an aim? You pose questions. Behind the questions is a thought, is something you're thinking about. Is that not an aim in itself? Do you not have a framework in which your therapeutic world is already set in?
Not really, no. I think that all aims are misleading because as soon as you have an aim, you set yourself up for success and failure. Success and failure is bullshit. You don't want to bother with success and failure. They don't help.
It's not about success and failure. It's about what your framework, what your matrix of thinking is. You have your own matrix, and you're a prisoner of your metrics, whether you want it or not. And you actually do things, think things, according to your metrics.
Well, at the mental ego level, I have a matrix. At the centaur level, I have a different matrix. At the subtle level, I have a different matrix again. At the causal level, I don't have a matrix. No.
If you wouldn't have had one, then you would have had not posed one question during the sitting.
Well, whatever I said arose out of that moment. Not thinking, not referring to my theory, not... It just happened. It was what I was needing to say at that moment. And one interesting thing about the causal is that there is no empathy at the causal level. You see, at the subtle level, there's huge, huge empathy, amazing empathy, transcendental empathy even. But at the causal level, there is no empathy.
I have the question, I'm fascinated of the different levels, but I have the question, is it the same for the different traditions? Me, for instance, I'm a yoga teacher.
Yeah.
And if I can see these levels.
Right.
But when you take LSD or when you make shamanism or something like this, do they also have these levels? I can't imagine. Or do they spring from one level?
LSD is very unique. It doesn't really belong in a kind of orderly sequence. Anything can happen depending on where the person is, where the person is located, what's going on at the time, all kinds of stuff, you know. So I won't talk about LSD. But shamanism is mostly subtle level stuff. As we meet it in the West, you know, there's sort of ancient shamanism, which is probably back in the magic mythic level, I don't know much about it. But the shamanism that I've met in America and in England and other places is very much to do with the subtle. You actually are going into the subtle realm where there are monsters, demons, angels, helpers of one kind and another, all kinds of stuff like that, and places and caves and all sorts of stuff. But so I think that's mainly subtle level stuff as we meet it in the world today, you know.
And what is this LSD and ayahuasca?
Well, I've never taken ayahuasca, so I've no knowledge of that. LSD I have taken, and I find it very useful in my own therapy as opening up doors which I had kept closed, and holding open the spring doors of the mind, so to speak. LSD is good for that, very useful for that. But, of course, once you've opened the door, it depends on who you are and what your experiences have been and so forth as to what you get. I don't think there's any rule about that, except that it's going to surprise you, probably.
Grazie. Volevo dire che secondo me l'obiettivo ce l'ha... Ah, ecco. Secondo me l'obiettivo è quello del paziente e lei giustamente ha detto noi abbiamo la funzione di accompagnare, di stare allo stesso livello.
Yes.
Allora, ripete? Allora, a mio parere l'obiettivo è l'obiettivo del paziente, non tanto nostro. E giustamente quando lei ha, noi, la nostra funzione è quella di accompagnare il paziente verso i suoi obiettivi. Noi lavoriamo spesso con le coppie, il problema è appunto che spesso i due coniugi non hanno lo stesso obiettivo, per esempio uno si vuole separare, l'altro vuole stare insieme, e qui nascono dei problemi, chiaramente. E la domanda che le volevo fare riguardava il fatto, questi stati che dice lei li vive, cioè le vede che nei pazienti c'è il passaggio, è lineare il passaggio, l'evoluzione, o è a spirale, o appunto un po' come dire caotica, si ripete, si ritorna indietro, poi si va avanti e via discorrendo. Grazie.
Yeah. Okay, let's make sure we don't get any whistling. Right. We have two questions there. One is the question of shouldn't you have the client's aims? If the client comes to you and says, these are my aims, these are my goals, isn't your job to... Isn't your job to... help the client to achieve those goals, those aims? And I say no. I say the client's aims, the client's goals, are just as neurotic as anything else about the client. I don't take them seriously at all. I work with the client to open up what is real for the client. And those aims and goals may not be very real at all. So that's one half of the answer. The other half of the answer was about is the development of these levels steady, sort of smooth development, or do people go backwards and forwards or whatever? The interesting thing is that it's a dialectical process. In other words, you can't go to one level without disowning the previous level. You may get very contemptuous of the previous level, in fact. Now, as time goes on, you lose that. That becomes, okay, that's one level, this is another level, that's okay. You know, they're both okay in their place. But it's essentially a dialectical process, so it's an emotional process. You move from one level to another with difficulty. It's not easy.
I appreciate very much your distinction of these levels, because that's also seed for sharing and discussion on these key points. I feel a bit uneasy, and I would like to have more explanation about the restriction of the word therapy to the second level only, in the sense that, especially in the transpersonal field, I feel that therapy, maybe it's the meaning of distinguishing all these levels in your presentation, includes also even the goal, for example, of psychotherapy, is to have the aim for the client to get better, not only get rid of symptoms perhaps, but even a more freer state. Anyway, therapy is not only the second one, and
no,
could include the others.
I agree. I don't think I said that. No, there's therapy at all these levels.
Okay.
Oh, yes. No, I don't restrict therapy to one level.
Because you said psychotherapy and counseling about the second.
No, so every level.
That was important for me to... Because the various levels could be in the therapeutic process. And as sure you want. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Okay. She was the first? Okay. Dove?
Ma non capisco, cioè. Allora, dopo averla vista lavorare a livello causale, la mia domanda mi sembra un po' fuori posto, ma la faccio lo stesso. Volevo capire, quando lei lavora con le persone, ci sono dei segnali esterni che le fanno capire a quale livello lei deve lavorare con il cliente? O lei è in uno stato particolare per cui lo è già in interazione senza parole?
No, I think this is just obvious, really. The client tells you through words, through gestures, through movements, through expressions on the face, all kinds of stuff tells you. You know, Freud said that the patient leaks information all the time. All his secrets leak out. All the time, and I don't think it's hard to tell what level a client is at, and what they talk about, how they talk about it. Everything tells you. I don't think it's hard to distinguish.
Yeah, I really respect your approach, and but it reminds me more of like I go to my spiritual teacher. And Zen teacher, and I say something, and she said, "Okay, who is talking?" Right. So it's more like a spiritual interview, and I'd like to understand, because when she said she wants to drop her mind or whatever, she wants to get rid of her mind, and you ask something, and she said, "Because I want to love." And I understood that her mind maybe is controlling her heart or something, and it's an obstacle on her way to love. So I would probably go into this direction. How is your mind bother you or controlling your heart, and what do you really want to, you know, express? But this is different. I understand this is different direction. So, but I just want if you can comment on it. Thank you. Yeah, thank you.
Yes, that's perfectly right. That's what I would have said if I'd been working at the any of the other levels, really, any of the other levels. It's only at the causal level that it stops making sense. And you're quite right that this is the kind of spiritual teacher approach, because you can't help being a spiritual teacher if you're at the causal level. That's how it comes out, you know. But it could still be useful in a therapeutic sense. I've had several instances of where I've done this kind of demonstration, and the person has gone right to the heart of their original wrong turning, so to speak. And we've been able to see, that's what you did. That's how you set yourself up to fail in this particular way, whatever it is. So it's very immediate. It's very direct. There's no sort of waiting about for something to happen. You just go for the most important thing straight away.
Volevo chiedere, volevo spostare un attimo la
aspetta un momento.
Ok. Ecco, volevo spostare un attimo l'attenzione chiedendo alla ragazza che è venuta lì, avevo bisogno di conoscere il suo feedback e di sapere, come si dice in italiano, fuori dai denti, cioè sinceramente, come è stata lì e come si sente adesso. Se lei si sente di dire, di spiegare questa cosa, se la ragazza si sente, se no fa lo stesso.
You don't have to answer that. You don't have to answer.
Io ho vissuto soprattutto negli istanti finali una sensazione proprio di pace totale, di parlavi di non empatia, ma l'unione che io sentivo con te era totale, era cosmica, era, non c'era più niente che separava, non c'era, era un campo totale e fuori dallo spazio, fuori dal tempo. Grazie.
La signorina ha proprio complementato ciò che io ho visto. Io vedo Laura e ho visto nell'aura che c'è stato quest'aura sua che si è spostato verso questa ragazza e c'era un filo di luce, un campo di luce che vi legava e io ho sentito che lei le diceva: io sono con te, io sono qui per te, io sono io, tu sei tu, ma siamo un pezzettino di cammino assieme, no? E quindi c'era questo incontro di anima più che di obiettivi, di raggiungerò questo o quell'altro. E quando c'è amore, credo che poi uno non ha più bisogno di amore, non credo che lei non aveva, ma c'era amore, quindi che bisogno c'è di trovare questo amore se c'è, no? Che è quello che ho visto proprio e che si illuminava tutto. Quindi l'amore è l'amore. E lei mi piace molto.
I'd just like to say something about that. At the causal level, there is a kind of love, but it's a kind of steady beam of love, so to speak. It's not particular. It's general. And it's like in Christianity they talk about agape. It's a kind of love that doesn't require anything back. No return is needed. And it's a bit like that. I think we've finished, so thank you very much for coming.